Hey, I know you guys. This is Jedi Council, and I'm back, and I'm actually somewhat rested. I don't know how it happened, but I got myself about 6 hours sleep, and in order to do that, one show today, and it's all for you guys, baby. It is Collider Jedi Council. We're back. The Council's back. It's going to be a fun show, and I'm joined by the Grand Moff, the Nemiroff, Perry Nemiroff.
I am so happy to be here, and I'm even happier that you're rested. It's going to be a really great positive show, right?
Yeah, absolutely, but let's not say well-rested.
Oh, okay.
Let's not say well-rested, because I'm getting there, but I do have popcorn, and I'm joined by Kylo Ken Napsok.
I had some popcorn. It's
you
all gone.
That out, huh?
Yeah, it's. I was hungry.
Perry,
I like your very Poe-like jacket. You look like a fighter pilot today.
You're the one that told me it was a Star. Mark Riley said it actually.
People confuse
that
it.
Mark Riley's an imbecile. It's a very Star Wars looking jacket, and I was all bummed that I didn't wear a T-shirt today that had Star Wars on it. So now I feel better about myself. Like
I am not wearing a Star Wars shirt, nor am I wearing a New England's Patriots shirt. I am wearing a Schmodown Patriots shirt because I'm looking forward for them tearing each other apart tomorrow. Okay, so let's get into our show that we call Star Wars. That's it. We call the show Star Wars. It is Jedi Council, and we're going to get into the first part of it, which we simply call Star Wars movie news. Why? Because we talk about, you guessed it, Star Wars television news. Ken, what is the first thing we're going to talk about here on this particular show today?
So glad you're back. You're chasing raccoons at home and raising kids.
Those raccoons are no joke.
No joke,
man.
You have raccoons?
Raccoons and possums, and they had a fight the other day.
I'll trade you my bees for your raccoons. No?
No, I like the raccoons.
Raccoons are kind of fun. They're cute and cuddly and deadly. All right, guys. First story of the week. We got two things to look out in this The Hollywood Reporter.
You heard of them.
Yeah. Had an interview with Rian Johnson. Also, USA Today released that behind-the-scenes featurette and a great little picture. We're going to start with that great little picture first. It is Luke Skywalker at the library. I love this garb. This is perhaps, you know, John Rocha has a good theory that this is one of them force trees. This is definitely on Octu, the site of the first Jedi temple where the caretakers are. And this also solves a mystery with that brown glove over that book we'd seen in that tease of Last Jedi a while ago of a gloved hand over something we thought was maybe the Journal of the Wills. Right. So this picture, it creates a lot of fun speculation, Christian.
Well, he's been... Look, the other thing that I really got out of the article when you hear what Rian Johnson's talking about is the fact that we're going to find out, we're going to get some explanation of why he did this, where he went, why he was gone. And I am a bit scared because in Bloodline, once again, we reference this all the time, it was said that at least 6 years before The Force Awakens, Luke was still running around with Ben Solo. I hope that they stick to that, and you would seem that they would because Rian Johnson, helped with that book. I just hope they don't retcon it. Like, oh yeah, Luke's been there for 10 or 15 years. Like, wait a minute, no, he hasn't. But he's definitely been studying. He's definitely been doing, you know, locking himself away and like Hunter S. Thompson in the middle of a, you know, shed somewhere. But it's that look alone. You assume he's looking at Rey because that's what we got from that trailer where he's very skeptical of her at first. And I'm theorizing right up top that the beginning of the movie, once again, is him saying, no thanks, tried this once before, you're not going to Tommy Gun me, I'm out of here. And he eventually, she wins him over. But I also think there's other things, there's rumors about who confronts them on Octu, what's going to happen. I think that it's really going to kickstart an entire adventure from, you know, Miyagi and Danielson. But Perry, you see this, you hear this, what do you think?
I would be shocked if they said anything in this movie that backtracked on what we got in Bloodline, because that is not the point of these books, and I think they've done such an exceptional job respecting everything in all different kinds of Star Wars stories, whether you're talking about Rebels, the movies, the books, comics. So That I don't think is anywhere in the realm of possibility. Okay. But looking at this image, this is the kind of image that I like to see from a movie. Because also going back to those quotes from Rian Johnson, one of the things he kept talking about is just how expressive Mark Hamill can be. And, you know, really, we know he's a very talented voice actor, but there's a lot of people out there who knew him from Star Wars,
right,
and they haven't really seen him act all that much outside of it. So I think it's important to remind people he is a crazy talented
guy.
Good at Kingsman. He is good in Kingsman. Yeah. And an image like this, I think, shows it in just one still frame. You're sitting here wanting to read his expression, understand what he's thinking, and the thought that we're going to find out why he is where he is, that's one of the most important things. You can't have an ending like you did in Force Awakens and not answer that question in a satisfying way. But just looking at that image, I love everything about it. I don't care if it's a Force tree or what. I love the look of that space. I love how the light's coming into the room. I love his expression, how his outfit is just lit up enough. Really, this is the kind of image I like that gets me thinking in a good way.
All right, let's talk about the Journal of the Wills a little bit, Ken, because I think that everybody's going to agree that that's probably exactly what that is. The question is, there's only like 8 books. It's not like you know, Jocasta knew guarding all those files terribly, by the way. I got to go back again. She's not good. She's not a good Jedi.
Not a good Jedi.
Not a good Jedi. She's really not.
She's a little snooty, too, to Obi-Wan.
Snooty, yeah. and just, you know, he's like, something's missing.
Yeah.
She's like, nothing's missing. I know about it. Well, clearly you don't. Jocasta knew is the worst Jedi of all time. But she's not here, thank goodness, because you got Luke is kind of hoarding these things. Did we think that he found some of them and maybe the First Temple? Maybe this is not where the First Temple was. Does it tie into anything that they were talking about in Rogue One? What do you got?
Yeah, well, first of all, about Luke's image in here, it looks like Robin Williams and the Fisher King. Like, this is like a crazy person's version of a Jedi here. But I, you raised a good point. You know, we know that he and Lor San Tekka at one point maybe went around the galaxy looking for things. So maybe this is Luke's collection that he's just brought in a bag all the time here, and he's like, would you want to come see my books? Yeah, I'm just a crazy hermit.
Right.
Or the idea that the caretakers have him there. And as far as the Journal of the Wills, I love that it's factored in, because since I read the Star Wars novelization as a kid, and it has a quote in the beginning of the novel from the Journal of the Wills, I've been literally, there'd be times I'd be searching for that book in used bookstores, like, Mom, no, there's a book called the Journal of the Wills. And so to actually have that come back into play with Rogue One and here, it's interesting. So I would love, Christian, if that's there. And if he opens it up and in there he's kind of reading stuff that pertain to the history of the Jedi, history of the Sith, maybe even the prophecy of the Chosen One.
Well, this is the opportunity that they have that I hope that they capitalize on, and I feel that they will, to really, I mean, the lore, a lot of the hardcore lore has been built in outside canon. It really has. Yep. A lot of the heart, like you're talking about with Wills and just stuff that happened in Knights of the Republic or comics or books, they have a chance to further it just a little bit. I know that some of the best Star Wars movies are pretty simple. Even the first movie is just an adventure story, you know, boys on desert, gets called into an adventure, goes to rescue princess, takes on the Empire. That's really the whole thing. This could have a lot more than that. They have the opportunity with the first Jedi temple, with you're saying the Sith and Jedi, and what was it all about, how much he learned, how much lore, what happened with his nephew. You think they're going to explore a lot of this?
I think they would be silly not to. Really, in every promotional material we've seen thus far, it very much highlights the conflict of how he's feeling about his abilities, the Force being a Jedi, and you need that kind of information to be featured in this movie in order to give his individual journey and whoever's journey he's connected to some context, and this is the perfect opportunity to do it. When we played that game on Movie Talk where we were pitching Star Wars standalone movies that we would like to see, as someone who has not read all the Legend stuff, I pitched the origins of the Jedi Order. I want to learn about that stuff. I know there's not a place in this movie for all that information, but dropping little nuggets this way, that could be the way to do it.
It just kind of confirms that stuff's out there. It's happened. You know, to hear it up on the big screen, they always say in Lucasfilm, what's on screen is the ultimate canon, even over the books. But going back to their Bloodline thing, number one, I hope you're right that they keep to that, and I think they will, especially with Ryan involved. But a lot can happen in 6 years. You know, you can get a lot of gray in your beard fast. Trust me.
That's true.
Trust me. That's true. But it's interesting there. And then the stuff about Rian Johnson.
Yeah.
This stuff, the featurette came out, which was focused on Rian, his pure joy at directing this movie.
Are we moving into that one now?
Yeah, let's look.
I want to move to it, but I do want to ask one other thing that I think Perry says that is true here. Like, let's say whatever they set up,
yeah.
Okay, they have the opportunity inside of this movie, because this is something that they never had to do before in the prequels or in the original trilogy, and they haven't really done, they did it in Force Awakens because they had to for the sequel, but it's set up nuggets for potentially spin-off films, mm-hmm. because they did it in Episode 4 without meaning to, because you know you get the Death Star and then that lore is built, and when you the opening crawl is plans have been stolen. Oh great, let's make a movie out of it. They got lucky with that one because it was set up. But if they have something to where Luke's telling some story, very simple. I mean, even like we're talking about Game of Thrones, right? Yeah. In Game of Thrones, how they mentioned, like you said, Robert's Rebellion, all these different things that, you know, there's stuff that's been mentioned that if you mention it and you make people care, just in one paragraph, if he can deliver a story, well, I want to see that movie. Like in Jaws, when they tell this story about the ship that sunk, and they're making movies about it, it's a true story, and it's like because you cared the way that it was delivered. That can happen inside of these movies and should happen. So I think you make a great point.
That's the way for them to pave the way to standalone movies right. that are detached from the characters that we've known for so long. I hope if that is in the movie the way I am hoping it will be, I hope they seize that opportunity and actually make standalone movies that, you know, aren't, I'm excited for young Han Solo, but aren't necessarily young so-and-so right. that you know so
Set
well.
Set it up. Ken, what do you got?
Yeah, well, we're talking about Rian Johnson. He's kind of the guy behind all this, as we know, and you mentioned the Bloodline connection with Claudia Gray hit mm-hmm. a home run writing that, but he had a little influence in one of the big scenes, so I'm interested to see how that stuff ties in. This is a guy who loves Star Wars, who gets Star Wars, and the behind-the-scenes featurette really focuses again on Rian, and there's this little section of Daisy Ridley again saying he's taking characters into places we didn't think, and there's some quotes also that came out in this interview here at the Hollywood Reporter, and the first one up says, when I first read, this is from Rian Johnson, when I first read the script of Force Awakens, I was like, I feel like I know these characters instantly. Now we get to kind of put them through a meat grinder. That's him laughing. And for me, part of that meant that we had to make things as hard on each of them as possible. And you can see the rest of the quote there. I want to start there, Christian, as we kind of break this out and maybe also look at the featurette. Like he said this time and time again, this is that second chapter, and that's where everyone's like, oh, it's an Empire thing. Right. No, it's just the second chapter of storytelling.
Right.
But things are going to get bad, and I love this idea that he's like, I love these characters. I know them instantly, including the classic characters, including the new characters. Let's mess things up for them.
And that's why you hire Rian Johnson. I mean, that's exactly why, because he's going to, it's not just because it's going to make it darker and give them, they're going to have problems now. It's because it's within those problems, you're going to start to really develop and show you who these people are. Because people don't, and we've said this already from the first film, after you see it and you go, Rey's too powerful, that's not right.
Right.
But you don't know why. Yeah. It's clearly already in this trailer, we have seen that there's something going on with her. And Luke says it, I've only seen this raw strength once before. Once. So, of course, you're like, wait, how is he so strong? We're going to find out.
Yeah.
Kylo Ren, he was whiny, he was grouchy. Yeah, but what is his progression? What's he going through? You can't judge it on just one movie.
Yeah.
That's why, like he said, I get the characters, and now he has a playground, and now he starts to develop them more, because you also don't realize that when you develop it, and let's say the second movie that we're hoping is going to be great, and you do get this development from these characters, you're going to appreciate The Force Awakens that much more, because you're going to see where they were in The Last Jedi and then go, well, look where they came from Force Awakens. They're so radically different. Let's say Rey does that turn. Let's say Rey does become a Sith and start the Sith with, it's not going to happen, I know, but let's say they start the Sith with Kylo Ren. You're going to want to see that origin story. You're going to want to see her like, oh man, she was this sweet kid. And they finally, now they got that turn right. As I still don't think they got the Anakin turn right. But anyway, so Perry, you know, you hear these comments and you see this featurette and, you know, Rian Johnson is kind of, seems more and more that he is the right guy for the job, minus not seeing the movie.
I love featurettes. I love behind-the-scenes pieces. I know people complained that one year at Star Wars Celebration when we got a Rogue One behind-the-scenes featurette mm-hmm. versus a new trailer,
there's a reason for that,
there's a reason for that. But as as a film and behind the scenes lover and as someone who wants to feel the joy that the people that are making these films feel while they're making it, really that got just as much of a reaction out of me as some great trailers that I've seen from whatever movie out there. But I like seeing this stuff. I like seeing all the behind the scenes stuff, the quotes though. And I love how you emphasize the idea of making everything as hard on these characters as possible, because really that's the meat of what he just said there. And you know, when you have a film franchise, a cinematic universe, whatever you want to call it, it gets increasingly difficult to keep the stakes high when you need to have a big bad, let's say, and that's just a way to simplify the idea, but you're in a position where you need to make that big bad bigger and badder every single time, and eventually it hits a point where it's like, all right, been there, done that. You need little elements that are tied to that mission that further the characters. And I love what he says about Poe when he's talking about Poe's growth. It takes more than heroics to be a leader. That right there connects him to whatever they're struggling through in this film on a grander scale, but it also gives him a personal journey that's directly tied to that. And that really is how each character should be growing from film to film.
Yeah, I mean, and we should, you know, compare it to Empire Strikes Back in a way, because not that it's going to have the same beats, but because these characters, you want it to follow a bit of the format. You want them to see, like we saw in Empire Strikes Back, when Han and Leia are on their separate adventure and they eventually wind up going to Bespin, you're with them. And then it switches over so beautifully to what Luke is doing. And even it switches over to what Vader is doing as he's on the search for Skywalker. And then ultimately at the end, all three of the stories combine into one. That should kind of happen here too. I mean, they don't necessarily have to mesh towards the end, or maybe they do. But I want to see the growth. I want to see what happens. Poe is absolutely an example of that. But the one thing, and I don't know if we have a picture of it, and we didn't prep the guys, so it's not their fault. But when Rose and Finn are walking, it's amazing that some people are like, I don't know. I don't think that's Benicio del Toro. It's clearly Benicio del Toro.
Right, it is.
Clearly, 100%.
I'm looking at the picture right now, and I didn't have doubts. I just was like, eh, it definitely looks like
him.
How do
you not think that's Benicio del Toro? It is 100%.
It's not that I don't think it is. I just didn't look that close, and I'm like,
eh, no, I'm not saying you. I'm just saying in general.
I'm taking it as personal accusation.
You should. You should.
I did have doubts, so now I'm giving it one more look.
You should. It's 100%.
I didn't stare at it so intently.
Wait,
but
it is 100% Benicio del Toro, and it also should. But that doesn't mean that he's necessarily a good guy. It means that he could be pulling a Lando type thing.
Yeah.
And he's just working with them for whatever it might be, but that's him. That's the character.
He's a slicer. He's a hacker. He can get in there. And Rian Johnson's got a great quote about Finn here, saying, "Laughing again, I can do my Rian laugh." Man, if I were him, just think of the moral courage it took and how much just physically it took to get away from the First Order. It's that thing of coming back to what's the thing that would be the toughest to throw at each of these people. And to go back into the machine, to put that uniform on again, made a lot of sense to me. So this isn't, on one hand, Christian, it's a awesome undercover mission, which is kind of cool. And that's a Star Wars trope and a story, big epic movie trope, of course. But this has some emotional impact on this character.
It does.
It's not just a, you know, it cuts deep.
I think it also takes away, though. I mean, I want to go back to the Benicio del Toro thing.
It's him.
Yeah.
It's like, I loved how my computer, the brightness wasn't all the way up, and I'm like, that's not him. And then as it increased, I'm like, oh.
Yeah.
No,
and well,
nobody has facial features like that.
I mean, that's definitely him. And the thing with that, I think what it answers, I think it answers the fact that he's not going to be a Sith Lord. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it answers the fact that it doesn't look like his story is going to be intertwined with Poe and Finn and Rose, and that's fine. I was just kind of hoping that he was eventually going to turn out to be the big bad of the whole franchise, because I don't think it's going to be Snoke. I really think it's a misdirect. I think Snoke's a misdirect. But I'm also a little bummed that that's the one way that they showed him, because people have been anticipating, where is he? What's he doing? What's happening? And like, well, there he is. He's just kind of, like you said, he's just... Yeah. just slicer, he's a hacker, and he's going to be with them. But we're not going to even give him the close-up.
Yeah. I'll take it. Yeah. I want some mystery, and as much as I want more of Laura Dern,
that's not mystery anymore. They gave it away.
I would rather
not show him.
It's not a complete mystery, but we also don't know until we see him on screen in a scene really what his personality is like. Because, I mean, even in the description we did get, you don't really know what his motives are and if he's good at heart
that's
or not.
True.
And that could completely change the character.
Right.
I love this idea with Finn, though. And it's actually even more appealing to me after I read Phasma. And, you know, Phasma wasn't my favorite book, but I do like having some background on her and what her responsibility was in terms of training stormtroopers. So now that I know that they had a relationship and then they're fighting in the trailer, him stepping back in there now gets that extra layer that I never thought it would. It's, you know, just having him put back on a uniform means something for that character, period. But knowing that he'll eventually confront Phasma, that just opens it up even more.
You know what, yes, sorry, Ken, I want to ask you about Phasma because I haven't been here for the last couple of weeks. I don't know. Did you guys review the book on the show?
We didn't get a chance to review the book. We finished it at very different times.
Well, so let me ask you a question with that book because I have not had a chance. You guys have both finished it. Did you read the Jason Fry book where it was the Journey of the Force Awakens right beforehand? It was like three different stories. It was Rey.
Before the Awakening.
Before the Awakening.
That was what I was going to bring up.
Is that where you're going to go?
Yeah.
Do they combine that inside of Phasma's novel?
Not necessarily combine it. And that's, I was going to suggest you read that before this one because it gives some history of Phasma.
I have Rebel Rising downloaded.
Well, do that as well. Beth Revis hit a home run there. But Christian was the one who said, hey, you know, this is important because Finn was one of Phasma's favorite students in a way. It's kind of.
Do they not mention that in the
They don't
novel?
Mention that really? Because okay. It doesn't. It's more about this rival of Phasma, Cardinal, trying to get some information. Mm-hmm. He's a fascinating character. Sure. They have this rebel spy. That's fascinating, interesting stuff. It goes to, you know, Phasma's home planet.
Oh, okay.
And it's different. Delilah S. Dawson wrote a great sci-fi thriller with some great Star Wars stuff in it.
Does it feel like Star Wars?
It doesn't at times, and that's not bad. Because what do we hear a lot about? I wish Star Wars would try something new in the pictures. Mm-hmm. It's hard to do in the pictures. In the books, you have that room. This is a Mad Max, Fury Road-ish type of sci-fi, post-apocalyptic book.
It's a good comparison to make. It has a very different feel. You know, it reminded me a little, at least, of getting into it, like Inferno Squad, where I had to live in it for a little while before I was ready to fully accept it. Also, they're jumping back and forth with where you are at the beginning of the book. So, really, the part of the book that I was fully invested and really into it was when they just stuck on Parnassus.
Yeah.
Then I felt like I was right there with them, but I like the different feel to it, and I think they pull in just enough elements that we're familiar with already. Yeah. Also, Brendel Hux, I love how he's incorporated and what that means for his son.
Yeah, all right. Well,
good stuff there.
I'm so curious to have a whole conversation about this with you guys because there was so much that was set up with Chuck Wendig's book that apparently that negates the whole thing, right?
Yeah, I mean the Wendig aftermath. Kind of that reference to a tall blonde
not her
child. I would say safely it's not her. Which so it's just a fun little Easter egg. Could be something else. Wendig having fun. Whether or not they changed direction because this was.
I bet you that's what it was.
You know, I heard there was something. I think even Delilah herself had said that Lucasfilm approached her and said, "Hey, could you help us kind of like save this character?" And I'm paraphrasing, so if that's wrong, but it's something of like, let's give something more to this character because people did feel a little cheated by the Force Awakens, which I think it just wasn't planned. They gender swapped the role. They get someone great in there, and people were like, "Yeah, oh, it's just that."
It also brings up the question, like, how many of the other novels do the authors read? You know what I mean? Like, do they read everyone that comes out, or do they go, or does Pablo or whoever say, you should read this before you get into that so you know everything that's going on?
I would hope that they would read the necessary ones. Also, because even when we're talking about something like Phasma that does feel isolated to a degree, the author of Phasma can't write that without being well aware of maybe what happened in Aftermath, what happened in all the movies.
Yeah. Oh, that's why I asked. Maybe she didn't read it.
Yeah, well, no. I mean, I would imagine the story group and Keri Hart and the team would sit down and be like, nope, and they each kind of oversee the comics, oversee this. That's a lot of lines to check off to make sure you're not crossing over. Like, from a certain point of view is a great example. Those 40 stories, 40 authors, a lot of them clearly knew what the other people were writing because they were connecting. There's little tiny connections. The story Eclipse by Madeline Rue was just spectacular.
You didn't like the overall book though, huh?
No, I did like
it.
I did, especially towards the end. I have a complicated relationship with From a Certain Point of View because there's, again, talk about different styles. Kelly Sue McConnick and Matt Fraction are two of my favorite comic book writers. Right. Fraction's run on Hawkeye is amazing. So they wrote this great, hilarious story. I totally recommend you reading it, but it gets a little weird and bizarre and out there, and it's like, what am I reading? So you kind of get lost in some of the stuff.
Right.
The biggest issue, problems, not the word I'll use, the biggest issue I have with the book is, as a sweaty fan, there's a lot of answers to questions that have been urban myths or jokes.
That were answered and you didn't want them answered.
Things on the playground. You're like, well, why did this happen? Sometimes we get those answers. And that's the problem with expectations. Yeah. That's not the answer I came up with in 1983. So now I'm fighting the book.
You know, let's get into canon because I'm going to ask you more about that because that's okay. Yeah, and we'll give the spoiler thing when it's time for because I want to know some of that stuff too.
Okay.
So let's get into next topic. Unless you got something else.
Well, we there's some more quotes here from Ryan if you want to keep talking about the featurette. The featurette reveals some stuff there. We got this one about Poe coming down next. Does Leia view Poe as her heir apparent to lead the resistance? And thanks to our friends at StarWarsNewsNet.com for kind of parsing this video out here. And he says, I think so. He's also got some growing to do, speaking of Poe. Poe's got to grow. She definitely saw the potential in him in The Last Jedi, and we dig that into that more. We've seen how heroic he is, and now we're going to see him challenged in terms of stepping up the next level. Like Perry said, it takes more than heroics to be a leader, or so I'm told. Ryan seems like a very nice, humble guy. This is exciting to me. I'll start a little bit because the character of Poe is obviously great. The character of Poe with Oscar Isaac, he brought so much life to that role in that jacket, as did Finn. But you can't just have him be a flyboy. And the Poe comic touches on that. I always talk about that issue 14, some great sad stuff about Leia saying, I'm not always going to be here. You're going to have to step up and not just fly around shooting people. So I want to see that with Poe. That's important to that character. Otherwise, he just does become a great pilot.
Well, especially from where he began in lore that he was supposed to die. Right. And it was the end of him. After the whole thing of rescuing Finn, and then because Oscar Isaac, you get him, to JJ's credit here, said no, let's write you in and do more with you. I think evolution for him would be watching like some of the great leaders that we've had in the past were fighter pilots or you know were in the wars, and then they became like Leia herself was a soldier really in the war, even though she was a princess, she ultimately became a soldier just fighting on the battlefield. Right. He could be one of those guys. Like, if you get into a new trilogy down the line, then maybe he's running the shop. I mean, that would be great. I would love to see him kind of, you know, become like the Aragorn of this story. That would be very interesting and a switch because you would never see it coming.
I'm looking for that internal battle of someone who likes to be in control and be behind the steering wheel of something where you could physically fight in the middle of the action yourself and having to remove yourself and more so just mentally process the removal of yourself in order to lead for the greater good rather than just fight, because that's what he knows how to do, and that's what the heroics versus leadership thing says to me is, you know, he's not going to be able to just put himself in the pilot seat and risk his life because he has a bigger purpose that he needs to learn how to accept. And Oscar Isaac, I can't get enough of him. And I think I'm thinking so much about that right now because of Suburbicon, where I was kind
of,
all right. Oscar Isaac steps into that movie and through the freaking roof. Energy,
for the 15 minutes
style,
he's in it, it's
flavor.
Great.
Oh, it's so good.
It's true.
I finally saw Ex Machina very late, and I want to dance like him. He's amazing, as is Donald Gleason. Final note about this, and we'll move on next story. I think there's a lot in this featurette. Check it out if you haven't had a chance. But regarding Carrie Fisher, this is what Ryan Johnson says, celebrating Carrie's performance. Having these scenes in the film recontextualized tragically with her not being here anymore, it's incredibly emotional. For the next few months, seeing the fans, the process, the loss, and celebrate her as Leia one last time, it's going to be intense. I think it's going to be really sad, but really joyful. I hope she really kicks butt as General Leia, and I'm happy for that. This is obviously one of the big things hanging over this movie.
Sure.
Going in, just as fans of Carrie, fans of growing up with Leia, as we all have, and different generations have grown up with her now. But, you know, everyone seems to be really, really excited for the world to see what she did in this movie. So that's comforting.
Well, it is. And as far as being emotional, we knew that for sure. But you just watch any reaction to The Last Jedi, the first trailer, and everyone from Perry to Ellis to whoever, it's the initial, they see her and go, oh, the breath just goes, she's like, this is exactly what he said. This is the last time we're going to see her as Leia. And it's sad, but it's also you're going to honor it. You can't wait to see what they're going to do with the character. It's absolutely one of those. It's the swan song of her career, and the fact that she went out as Leia, you know, there's a poetic thing to it as well. But I think that you're just watching the movie and you're going to be thinking about her. It's going to be hard not to. I mean, you're in, and this isn't in a bad way, but you're, the second she comes on screen, you'll be sucked out for a second.
Yeah.
And you're going to be wrapped in your emotions and you'll go right back in because she's Carrie Fisher and she's Princess Leia, and you'll be sucked in on the adventure. But I want to know what they're going to do with the character because of the way that they've just been setting her up in general. And again, with Bloodline or with the Leia novel, like, she's using the Force in this movie.
Yeah.
One way or another, she's using the Force. And I think that Ryan Johnson, that he was able to, again, further the story of a character that was established. Like these other ones, Poe, Finn, Rey, like they all have the next chapter two. Now this is what chapter four or five, depending on, you know, Rogue One, if you want to count that. But this is another episode for Leia, for him to kind of further the characters. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I mean, even hearing you say some of the things you just said make me all sensitive again, and there's no denying that. This is one of those situations where you can't separate right. the feature narrative from reality, and I'm curious to see how they play with that, because they have no choice, and you want them to do it in a respectful way, but they need to incorporate it into the story in a way that both serves this film and the films that come after it. I'm very interested to see what they wound up with, but at the same time, I'm nervous.
Of course, right.
You know, nobody likes to, I mean, yeah, you want to cry during movies when it calls for an emotional moment, but as someone who doesn't cry often, it's just, I can't even watch the trailer without kind of feeling that bubbling up, and I just know when this movie comes to an end, no matter what the fate of Princess Leia is, General Organa now, no matter where that character winds up at the end of this movie, I'm not going to be able to control that.
Okay.
I mean, I still sometimes cry just thinking of Star Wars Celebration and the tribute to her, John Williams showing up to do Leia's theme live. This is it's going to be interesting to watch. I just, nervous is a good way to describe it. We grew up with this character. Like I said before, it impacted you as a boy growing up about what you know how you view a strong female character as a girl growing up. You looked at her as one of the only ones out there to look up to, unfortunately. So there's so many people, so many different takes on this, and I'm just nervous, Perry. Those are the good words to say.
We can cry together. It's okay.
Oh, we will.
All right, what's next?
Next up, sticking with Rian Johnson here, but this answers pretty directly this idea of Rian Johnson's involvement in Episode 9. We had heard a while back, a long time ago, Johnson's going to direct 8, write 8, write 9. That was just this little thing that popped out in the internet, right? Because you can always trust the internet. But now this is directly from him again in this Hollywood Reporter interview saying, J.J. Abrams is doing a third movie. I'm not involved in it. They'll be writing their own story, but continuing on what we did. So Rian Johnson seems to be pretty open, cagey when he needs to be, Christian. But it would seem that that's pretty direct answer right now.
I believe him. I wish I didn't believe him, but I believe him. I think that, you know, I also think that he's not going to put his phone to voicemail if JJ calls him for some help. You know, right. It's like, because there will be those phone calls as far as like, oh, you know, I know you were thinking about this and that. What do you think? I think he'll be there to help advise should they need him. But yeah, I mean, we haven't seen episode 8, so we're all assuming that it's going to be a great movie. And keeping along with that assumption, if it is a great movie, you're going to think going into it, it's a loss. I wish they would have kept the writer of that movie, or at least had him write the movie and have JJ direct it. That would have been great. But they're not. And I also must say that I liked JJ's comments. I don't know if it was last week or the week after, where he, without saying as much, I've been listening to everything you guys are saying. Don't worry. It's going to be different. I'm going to make it different. He has to make it different.
Yeah.
He's also a smart guy, a very smart guy. He will make it different. Now, Rian Johnson is not going to lie to us and say, nope, not involved. And then it's like, written by Rian Johnson. It's not going to happen. Get over it at this point. It's JJ. Let's deal with it. I believe him that he said he's going to make it different. Now, if he didn't say anything at all, I'd be skeptical. But he's telling me that he's telling me he's reading the comments. He's telling me he's understanding what Star Wars fans are saying. Right. Now, you don't have to listen to all the comments, because some of that will drive you bananas. But when there's a consensus, when he's just like, all right, well, we've all said it. JJ did the job he needed to do, and that was get us back. Let's understand. Introduce new characters. And with doing that, gives Rian Johnson this platform to do it. And then JJ, to his credit, hopefully, would be doing himself a disservice if he just rehashed a third movie to make it seem comfortable. He can't play it safe. He can't. But Rian Johnson's comments, I believe 100%.
Yeah, I can't look at that comment that he gave any other way, because it's not even, you know, there's no ums or stuttering in here. There are three very clear, succinct sentences right here. That is what it is. I'm not surprised that is what it is, but I do hope those phone calls happen. I think that's what I'm more worried about than anything, that I don't want it to be a clean break. And like you, that's working with the assumption that episode 8 is going to blow our minds. Right. And I'm going into it really hopeful that that's going to be the case. And if and when that is the case, I'm going to walk away saying, oh, well, I hope you keep talking to that guy that did such a good job with this property. And I was one of the people that when JJ was announced to come back, I'm all for it because I do think he did exactly what he needed to do in The Force Awakens. Mm-hmm. I do not think we would be talking about Star Wars quite the same way had he not made that movie in a way that appeased fans of the originals, of the prequels, and newcomers that have never touched anything at all. And I think he did accomplish that in every single respect. It's just, you know, we're walking into something that people have built up in a way that suggests it's going to be great. Rian Johnson is clearly, based on everything we've heard, a talented, pleasurable guy to work with.
Right.
Why wouldn't you want him involved in some capacity?
Right. Ken?
Yeah, I love what Rian Johnson's doing, just handling stuff. There's this quote here I want to talk about, too, but they asked him about the speculation surrounding that latest poster, and has Luke gone over the dark side? And like Christian, like you said, sometimes comments can get in your head,
right.
There's you know, a lot of passionate fans out there. But he said, Rian says, having been a Star Wars fan myself past 40 years, having spent most of my life on the other side of the curtain, I know the anticipation and the guesswork and theorizing is all part of the fun and game of it, so I love it. I love seeing what people are thinking, seeing what they're guessing, seeing what they're anticipating. So I just love what this guy's doing.
Yeah.
So I'm disappointed that he wouldn't go on to 9, but I'm on the record. We talked about it. I'm happy with JJ, but I definitely believe Rian.
Did you guys talk about that last week, about the fact that that silly theory about like all the bad guys were in the back of the poster?
We've mentioned it. Yeah.
And then I said, because I wrote, well, Anakin is,
are we talking about
the
posters? Yeah, too? Yeah, no, that one would come a little bit after, but yeah, you're right.
But everyone's like, oh, Luke's in the back, and every Star Wars poster has had the bad guy in the back. Episode 2 at Anakin. And like, well, he killed sand people. Doesn't make him the bad guy. He did a horrible thing, but he wasn't the antagonist of the movie.
No.
So the theory doesn't right there water. Doesn't hold water. No.
A lot of theories don't rely on facts.
Yeah, that's
know.
True. All right. What's next?
Final one here in movie news. Real quick, and we've done some talking about this before, but we would be remiss if we didn't address it here, and that is the movie, The Last Jedi, that we're living our lives for, is on track for a $215 million opening weekend, falling short of Force Awakens. Gee, but, you know, that's only like the second all-time if that actually happens. Christian, we talked about it already, but
yeah,
you think this
talk.
Is accurate?
I think that 215 is a safe bet. I know that some people... Remember, when Force Awakens came out, I didn't think Force Awakens was gonna crack. I forget. I mean, I don't remember.
Well, there was
stuff
because 100 million hadn't even happened.
It had never happened before, and I thought because of weather and, you know, the summer does the numbers it does because everyone's out of school, and Star Wars just proves again and again it's a different animal. So getting back to 200 million is not going to be hard to do because you're looking at the sequel to the most profitable domestic film of all time, domestic U.S. obviously, and. I think that this one, a 215, is safe. I think that 230 is possible, but I think 215 is safe. You are the box office lady. What do you think?
Yeah. So they say 215. It's more, it seems more in the realm of possibility that I think it'll go a little higher,
but not
match what The Force Awakens opened with, which was 247.
Right.
But there's part of me that wants to give it the benefit of the doubt and say that this movie will have a chance of matching that if the reviews are through the roof.
Mm-hmm.
If leading up to that, people are freaking out about how damn good this movie is, especially if they wind up with poll quotes that say it's even better than The Force Awakens, that could be the push it needs, especially because release-wise, Last Jedi is in the same position as The Force Awakens was, where the two weekends before... Mm-hmm. There wasn't much competition. So this thing has everything available to it. So if the reviews are great, if early buzz is as special as it needs to be, I still think it has a good shot at flirting with that 247 number.
Wow. See, I think it always makes money, the most money that it makes in the repeat business. And I think that, to Perry's point, is if it's good, it has a chance to catch up to Force Awakens' domestic record because of... It's a longer movie. It's from rumors is that it's the, or maybe even it's official at this point. I don't know, but it's the longest Star Wars movie ever made, if that's correct.
Mm-hmm.
Which will, but the flip side of that is that theaters are going to do what they didn't do with The Force Awakens, and that's some theaters are going to just run it 24 hours a day. Right. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, it is always fun to track the Star Wars box office because you never know what the hell's going to go on with it.
Yeah, I think one of the keys is not just being good, but specifically we hear these different things.
Right.
This movie's going to have different things. If those different things make us all go, what was that?
I'd rather it have the same.
Yeah, man, right. It might be a very impressive 215, but if it's like, holy crap, they did that, I got to go back and take that in as a Star Wars fan, then that number will start to rise.
Given what we've been talking about also, I also think that this movie, even more so than The Force Awakens, might be in a position where it has certain character reveals that force people to see it opening weekend, because I mean it's like what we've been talking about with Stranger Things coming out this Friday versus other Netflix shows that come out where I'll watch that when I get to it. No, something about Stranger Things is making a whole lot of people out there say I need to watch everything that night so nothing's ruined. I just have a feeling that there's stuff in The Last Jedi that's going to make people think I need to see it opening weekend, and it's going to inflate that number a little.
Yeah. All right, Ken.
That's it for movie news.
Now we're going to move on to the segment of the show. Haven't been able to do it in a little bit, and I'm pretty excited. What's the deal with canon? Everything in the world of Star Wars that relates to the movies, comic books, video games, novels, whatever they might be, we're going to talk about it. And the first thing I do want to talk, let's go back to what you're talking about with certain point of view.
Yeah.
Give me some of those myths. Put a spoiler up if you please, guys.
Thank you, Adam.
So this is if you want to read certain point of view and you don't want to know what's happening in some of the reveals, I suggest for at least the next 3 or 4 minutes, skip ahead because Ken's going to tell me some of those spoilers.
What do you want to know? Have you read it either?
I haven't read it.
Do you want these spoilers too? You can leave.
It's okay.
If you want.
No, it's okay.
No, there's some fascinating stuff. There's
stuff you liked and stuff you didn't like.
Stuff the best story in the book.
Yeah.
There's two that stand out to me. One of them is with Anakin.
Uh-huh.
Anakin. Yeah. One of them is with Obi-Wan.
Obi-Wan.
His best friend.
They knew each other.
There's two stories with Obi-Wan. One, he talks to Qui-Gon Jinn. This is during the moment where he...
On Tatooine?
3PO and R2 are burning the Jawa's bodies, and Luke's gone.
Oh, wow.
And Qui-Gon, he calls on Qui-Gon. Qui-Gon shows up, and it answers a little bit about how Jedi manifest themselves. How it's almost kind of painful to reform your body and have this conversation. And Qui-Gon is... As the future moves and, you know, is always in motion, as Yoda says, Qui-Gon is aware that he's talking to someone who's going to be joining him soon.
Oh, wow.
And can't tell him that. Mm. And so it's bittersweet. It really has some great prequel connections.
That's awesome.
And there's also...
See, that makes me want to read it anymore.
There's some great stories. And also the moment Obi-Wan dies. There's this conversation. He's like, hello, I'm Obi-Wan Kenobi, and I'm dead. And it goes through what's happening. He's being pushed through and pulled back through the Force. So there's stuff going back to where Luke was about 3 or 4 in an altercation with some pirates and some raiders.
Yeah, and that was in the comics.
It's a little bit of that, but this is more specific with Uncle Owen and Beru. It touches on a little bit of how he and Beru maybe had a little bit of a connection, Obi-Wan dropping off things and stuff for Luke.
Yeah, but all that stuff is in the comics.
Yeah.
Remember that in the hut, and she brings him stuff?
You're right. It connects to that. The other one, this is perhaps the biggest one. So definitely, if you don't just want to read it and learn
it's
it.
The Boba Fett?
The no comment on the Boba Fett one.
Okay. You don't like the Boba Fett one?
No comment on the Boba Fett one.
You don't like it.
I don't like it. no, sir, I don't like it.
Is that the one you're going to talk about?
No.
Okay.
There is a story with Yoda.
Tell me.
On Dagobah.
What do you got?
And Yoda goes through his daily life. What it's like, Dagobah gets flooded during the winter. He has to go to higher ground. He has a little cup from Obi-Wan Kenobi when Obi-Wan was a Padawan. And he has to fight a probot who's searching for him there, has to use that cup. Also, the blanket Yoda curls up in is Qui-Gon Jinn's cloak.
Oh, really?
So it's a connection there. But also, Yoda is kind of grumpy. He's also a little old. He knows his end is near. He's lonely. And he's bemoaning. He's like, I wish... I had my lightsaber. I so wanted to give it to Skywalker. I so wanted to pass it on to Skywalker. I wanted to train Skywalker because Skywalker was focused, determined, had grace, dignity. And then there's that other kid on Tatooine who's reckless and abandoned like his father. Yoda thought Leia was the one.
Oh, wow.
And we know that, of course, from Empire, but to see it explained out fully. And then Obi-Wan, in ghost form, kind of shows up, gets in a debate with him. Basically saying, no, I'm sending you Luke. And Yoda's like, I don't want that one.
Right.
Get me the other one. and it's a great moment. It's a big reveal. That's awesome. To kind of, you know, again, is it a reveal surprise? No, Yoda and Empire says there is another one, but it also answers that question. That's definitely Leia. And two, it's just it's oddly emotional. The other one, I will say, Eclipse, which is by my friend Madeline Rue, brought me to tears. It's the last moments of Bail and Breha Organa, and it is so well written and is so.
Did it help reading Leia?
It connects to Leia. It does. You had talked about do authors connect. I don't know if they sat down and had a cup of coffee, but there's the droids and everything. But it's seamless. You could almost put it at the end of Claudia Gray's book, and it would feel.
Which one did Claudia Gray write?
She wrote one of the. She wrote the first Obi-Wan one.
Okay, that no, the one. Which one though?
The Qui-Gon's ghost and all that kind of
stuff. Okay, great.
Yeah. So there's some great stuff. I highly recommend checking out because it also goes through, it can get repetitive, and that's part of the problem, is you read about four or five stories in a row and you're like, I already read this.
Right.
But they're all good. But the Death Star battle, the Battle of Yavin 4, they go through, sometimes there's some weird contradictions in a way, but there's some fascinating stuff. It just sometimes, it was really high reaching and high concept, so sometimes you're going to reach for things. There's a story about fake Wedge.
Yeah.
That was almost a little too meta, but it's great. It goes through the battle, but you go through a lot of that stuff time and time again. There's a sad tale about a Jawa who dreamed of being in space. Dianoga, who I believe his name's Omi, which is, you know, the trash monster, right?
Right.
She's not a monster. It's a warrior from another planet was captured. And it turns out it's force sensitive.
That's pretty, really?
And it connects to Luke. And that's why it pulls Luke down. The story is called The Baptist. It is so bizarre. It is the most bizarre Star Wars story I think I've ever read, but it's beautiful.
Yeah.
That might not be for everybody, but it definitely. I love the stuff, and me I'm a fan of Imperial Officers. There's some great stuff with Cassio Tag, Conan Antonio Mota, Pablo Hidalgo wrote an interesting one with Tarkin and Krennic, connected them. So there's a lot of stuff like that.
Oh man, I mean you sold me on it. I have the book, and I haven't picked it up.
I have a selfish question. What order am I going in now? So I have to read Rebel Rising. I have to read this. And then what was the Force Awakens book you just recommended?
Before the Awakening.
Before the Awakening. But that's a quick
read. Rebel Rising, get going. Get into it.
Yeah.
This one you can it's one story at a time. Some of them are kind of short. Some of them, the Cluehorn Caper is the longest one.
Right. You could read them as like little separate novels.
You could read them as a second one. Cluehorn, all the stuff on Tatooine is interesting because it canonizes Akmena, who is Bea Arthur's character from the holiday special.
Okay.
She's the nighttime bartender. There's some good stuff there. Wendig's story on Wuher, the bartender, is great as well.
Yeah. Well, Ken, thank you for breaking that down for sure. Let's get into our first real canon story.
Yeah, we want to look back and look ahead here at the two episodes of Star Wars Rebels in the Name of the Rebellion. We've all had a chance. Now, Perry and I broke it down in full, but Christian, I'd be remiss if we didn't get your reaction.
No, I'll be back on Rebels, the Rebels review, starting on Monday. I have seen the first four episodes. Excuse me. I will say
that popcorn.
It was absolutely, and I have water though, so I got to drink that. But the first episode I liked because that's the one we saw at Star Wars Celebration with the Mandalorians and Spine, and watching that all go down. Something happens at the end of that episode. I was like, wow, they really went there. That's amazing. And then they negate that in the next episode. I was like, oh, that's kind of lame. I didn't like the second episode at all. I thought the second episode was what I had kind of issues with when I don't like Rebels. They do things like this, and I was like, oh, this is like everything and. And you and I had the conversation with it that maybe that the suggestion was that maybe they did that because it's a Disney show. But it's like, no, they've done some stuff and they've taken some big risks before that it just seems, I think more, Perry had made a great point, was that, you know, Sabine, for certain things that, if this particular thing would have happened in this episode that we thought, then Sabine's character would be different going through the entire season. And they already have to deal with Ezra doing this stuff.
Right.
So keeping Sabine the way she was, it made sense. The third and fourth, though, I loved. The stuff with Saw Gerrera, rumors, whispers. Like, he's so cartoonish in general. But when they bring him on that show, Saw Gerrera was handled great. Ezra's starting to piss me off a little bit. But, just kind of, let's get somewhere with him. Yeah. It's like, because they went a while where it looked like he was going to go with Maul, and then he's flopping around in the second episode with the jetpack. He turned into Anakin in Phantom Menace. It's like, come on, are you a Jedi or just a douche on the loose?
What did you at least think about the Bo-Katan ending to that storyline?
Dug that. I thought that was Filoni that was pretty much wrapping up Clone Wars to what he wanted to do. And I thought that good on him that he was able to do that, because there were so many stories he wanted to finish that he couldn't do. So he did that. And I think that's also an indication of that we'll get more stories completing and answers done throughout this series.
Looking ahead, though, we got stuff from this next one-hour block. They're doing these back-to-back episodes for the first half of the season, at least. We got some interesting things. This is The Occupation. We also got Flight of the Defender. That looks like it's going to be Ezra and Sabine running into some problems where they try to steal a TIE Defender.
Yep.
And that was interesting because we're finally going to see that wolf, or at least part of that wolf storyline. Is it Ahsoka? The spirit of Ahsoka? Right. I don't think so, but it'll be interesting.
I don't think so either. So we're going to find out some answers for sure. We're going to get some, and like I said, myself, Perry, and Ken will be breaking down the entire season. So every Monday, make sure you check it out here on Collider for all your Rebels reviews. All right, Ken, what's next?
All right, sticking with Rebels, a little interesting thing here, talking about our good buddy Dave Filoni. We love Dave Filoni. He is, in many ways, George Lucas's heir apparent,
I think so.
Still to this day. And on comicbook.com, he was speaking to them, and he revealed his favorite Star Wars Rebel moment, the moment he is most proud of.
What was that?
It is the Ahsoka facing Vader moment in the Malachor episodes where Ahsoka confronts Vader. Big moment for me as a storyteller because it's something I had thought about for a long time and theorizing how it's going to be. How it's going to go is one thing, but actually after making it concrete and putting it on film is another, because that's how it is. He also tips a little tip that there's some great moments are still on the way this season of Star Wars Rebels, which I wouldn't be surprised that we're going to get something big. But yeah, this moment is also, too, my favorite moment in Star Wars
Mine, too, I think, because when you look at what Ahsoka's gone through as a character, and Filoni, who's the one who pitched her to Lucas, who wanted to bring her into the fray, and then she is destroyed the first time they introduce her. Fans hate her, calling her the next worse than Jar Jar Binks. And to have this arc to becoming one of the most beloved characters, and to also introduce it that it was Anakin's Padawan, ultimately leading to this and that emotional moment, the season finale, I could see why that's your favorite moment. Of course it is. And when you even see the cracked mask of Vader with the look and to see what Anakin was, and he's still a bit human in there, but not really. Of course, when you're Dave Filoni and that's your number one moment, I'd say, yeah, I can respect that choice completely.
This is exactly what I would have predicted his answer would be. Yeah. And I think this is what many people's answers would be. The second I met that guy over there, I had to gobble up every piece of Star Wars material I could get my hands on beyond just the feature films. But that was the moment that opened the door to Clone Wars to me. Not in that I was shutting it out before, but that made it require. Going back.
Oh, watching.
Because
it.
I had never seen Clone Wars when I started Rebels. And that made it required viewing, and it led me to the Ahsoka book. So I give that moment a lot of credit because it just enhanced my Star Wars love in a great way.
Yeah, everything. I echo everything you guys say. It hit me in the same spot. I love this character going from a little annoying snips to this awesome, well-rounded character who goes through some very dark things. I love that moment.
All right. Well, what's next, Ken?
Next, we're going to talk about Mace Windu number 3, one of the comics out this week.
This is all you, buddy.
I got a chance to read it here. Look, you guys know I'm a prequelist. I love this stuff. I love Mace. This comic series has been pretty good. It's great to see him and Kit Fisto in action. They're on this planet. They're fighting another droid leader. There's a great interaction between that droid leader and General Grievous. And, I think Grievous is a great character that we didn't get the best of on screen, so I always love some Grievous stuff. The most interesting thing in here, and we'll see where the story
goes.
Love
the cover.
Yeah, great cover. Where the story goes, there's a Jedi Master with Mace on his little strike team here. There's a rookie with his Jedi Master Dibs, I believe. My font is really small on this Comixology page. They get in confrontation late in the story, and that's going to lead to maybe next week or next month's issue of them fighting Jedi versus Jedi. At least that's what the cover is teasing. But there's a great moment because the big question this comic has asked and is trying to answer, and we also saw it in the Kanan comic a little bit with his master, Dalaba, the Jedi with military titles, the Jedi as generals being involved in this, didn't sit well with a lot of Jedi, and that is the crux of this confrontation. As things are going on, Mace maybe has some information that he was keeping or that some of the High Jedi Council was keeping from the lower Jedi Masters. So it's interesting to see the Jedi infighting, which is something that does come into play, but especially by the time Revenge of Sith is in full swing. And this idea of should the Jedi have military titles It's a good stuff.
Okay.
It's a good stuff. It's a good stuff.
It's a good stuff. Is that the last of it?
That is the last of that. I've got, we can talk about the preview of Legends Luke Skywalker if you want.
Yeah, I mean, I have a copy of it. I'm gonna start reading it. I'm gonna crack into it to find out some more about it. But I mean, this to me is one of my most anticipated ones to finally have some more about what Luke was doing, because that's what I thought. The first canon book we ever really got was the Tales of a Jedi or Path of a Jedi, whatever that thing was called, and it was awful. And it was, and when you heard about what it was supposed to be, it was
Heir to the Jedi.
It was a Legends book that they just said, this could work as canon. Let's make it canon. And that was the first one they launched with. And I was like, if this is what we're going to go with, we're going to be in trouble here with the history, with the future of the books. But they just haven't had something yet. Look at the cover. I mean, you get old Luke. You have you have the Luke from Empire. You've got Luke from New Hope. I believe that's Alderaan in the back. There's Tatooine on the bottom right. That to me tells me exactly that's the book I want. I want to learn more about it. And even the first page that I read or just saw was the myth. It's all about the myth of Luke Skywalker. And I think even from hearing what we heard about inside when you're reading these stories, you're supposed to feel like, was this true? Was this not true? It's all the myth of Luke Skywalker.
That's an interesting and dangerous place to play in, which is what has me so intrigued with this book, because, I mean, you guys know me well enough at this point. I like things logical, where every little detail connects and makes sense. So trying to wrap my head around what this book is going to explore, I'm very curious to see how I react. But that link you sent out, I read up until the spoiler point, and their reaction to having read this, it's interesting. It's kind of what I want, the way it's going to lead up to what we're going to see in The Last Jedi. So this, to me, it sounds like required reading before we get into that, because it's going to, it will not necessarily shape what you think about Luke when we first get back with him in The Last Jedi, but it's going to give you more insight, but also not necessarily the insight that is fact.
Sure.
And playing in that area is just very interesting to me.
I agree.
Absolutely. I'm looking forward to it as well, based on this. One of my favorite little moments from The Force Awakens is Rey reacting to the name Luke Skywalker. I thought Luke Skywalker was a myth.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's the quote, by the way. It's Rey's quote that starts off the whole thing.
As it should be, because this is what it is. I like the idea, because there's some of these reveals I've seen and we've been talking about off air.
Yeah.
That I'm like, I don't think that happened. But the nice thing about this book is it might not have happened.
That's
it
true.
Might not have happened that way. And that's part of fun, because I still talk of the Dark Horse 4-issue comic run called Rebel Heist towards the end of Dark Horse's run with the Star Wars license. Told the stories of Luke, Han, Chewbacca on missions from the point of view of other people in the galaxy who were like celebrities. And like, oh my God, I met Han Solo. And this book kind of has that kind of feel. It's a Bill Brasky SNL sketch here going on, and I like that idea.
All right, well, now it's time to move on to hear from you guys. And the way we do that, you guys tweet. You hashtag Collider Jedi Council. You put it out there in the Twittersphere, and we go through it, and then we start answering questions. Ken, we got a couple. What do we got?
All right, I'm going to jump around the board, Adam. And I, we're good at doing this, Adam, right? We got this rhythm down. All right, this last one here, we're going down the bottom. William Tingerthal, King of the Mooners. That is a name.
Yep.
And an action. Where do you think Kylo Ren got his kyber crystal? Is it possible he stole it from Luke's green lightsaber? Maybe bled that blade, I'll add. Thoughts on that, Council?
Well, if you look at the title of this video, that's why you clicked on, because that's what we're going to talk about. Where did Kylo Ren get his kyber crystal? Well, the thing is, I think the reason why this person maybe poses the fact that he got it from the green lightsaber is that if you look at that scene, that Rey's vision, a lot of people have speculated that on his hilt is Luke's lightsaber. And so maybe that's where he did it. And then if you look at the Vader comet, he made the crystal bleed, and that's why you're able to get the red. You have to
take a lightsaber.
You got to corrupt the crystal.
Mm-hmm. Put your pain into it.
So what I think he did, though, I don't think that was the case, because I still cannot remember where the hell I read that theory. I believe the theory 100% that vision of what Lucas, I think that's the future. I think that is the future. Mm. I think that when you look at, because in the, and even more so now, when you look at that vision, Kylo Ren is going, it looks like he's protecting Rey in the vision. It doesn't look like he's attacking her. He goes fast towards her, but then where it's set up, it looks like it might be where it's set up in the shots in the trailer. He might get Luke's saber then.
Right.
I think that they're going to have a battle, and maybe he overpowers Luke, because you wouldn't be expecting that. Yeah. You wouldn't be expecting it. It'll piss off some people, but you wouldn't be expecting it. But what I do think happened was that same thing that happened with Vader, Kylo Ren killed one of those Jedi that Luke trained and took that. That's why it's so faulty, too. That thing is not as, you know, solid as other sabers, for sure. So I think that he just corrupted a crystal from one of the Jedi.
Yeah, it's one of the things I loved about Kylo's lightsaber from the beginning, other than I was one of the people that like, that's cool, I like it, it's a broad saber, I'm on board for that. I liked that, but the exhaust, everything, because it's cracked, like it's unstable, that's his character. It shows a lot about him here. So this idea that he got it from Luke's green lightsaber, which, you know, is missing, or at least not shown yet. Luke, Rey could hand him this one and be like, I'm good, I got one. But I like that idea that Kylo would have to put his pain into that one, and then maybe that's part of the reason why it's cracked and broken, because there's just too many opposing forces going in. It's a cool theory. I love the idea of something being also connected with Endor. I've seen some theories of maybe Luke's Jedi school was on Endor. Right. Maybe that's why he's got Vader's thing. Also like the idea of Ren and the Knights of Ren going around collecting Sith relics, which was touched upon a little bit with the Acolytes of Beyond and Aftermath. But that theory, I can get behind it, William. It's fun. Like, it connects, and all these lightsabers have their own little story. That would be an interesting one.
I like
Luke's.
That idea, too. I like the idea of lightsabers and the kyber crystals having stories. But my mind went immediately to what you just brought up, and it's Aftermath. So I'm just wondering, what is the truth behind that lightsaber that everybody's walking around saying and trying to sell as Vader? And when is that going to come into play? Because I imagine they wouldn't bring it up, even though it was part of an interlude that way, if it wouldn't play some sort of point in the story at some point. It would seem to make sense to me.
And from all the rumors that you hear, too, that Luke's got that kyber crystal around his neck, and people think that it's Vader's kyber crystal from his saber, and maybe we'll find that out. All right, Ken, let's do two more.
I will do one kind of deeper one, and one kind of fun one here. This is from Aaron Skrzewski, I believe, there. Adam, do you guys think Star Wars Rebels has foreshadowed Luke Skywalker's character development with Ahsoka and the Bendu? Talking about someone being in the middle. The term I don't like, gray Jedi, right. But I do understand conflicted Jedi. Ahsoka never became a Jedi. She's one with the Force. She's on the good side, but, you know, she walked away. Her blades are white for a reason now. And We got to see the Bendu in action. I thought it was a great thing. It ties to some old Lucas stuff, but I'm the one in the middle, the Bendu. Could it tie into some bigger way?
I don't think so. I don't think it will. I think that Luke had his moment in Rebels with the Obi-Wan storyline when you see him kind of run through. That's also one of my favorite moments in all of Rebels, when that music kicks in and Obi-Wan pulls up and sees him just kind of run through, and you hear Beru, Luke, like that to me is a great moment. I don't think this is a foreshadow for Luke, but I understand why you would ask.
I don't think it's a direct foreshadow, but I think I said this the moment I saw the Bendu in action, was I do think that is in a way paving a way to the themes and the ideas we're going to be exploring in The Last Jedi, because really you want to see that from more perspectives other than this one character that we've known for so long. You want to see how other people out there can be conflicted, light versus dark, good versus evil, and we're seeing that across the board. So I don't think he's going to run into a Bendu and it's going to be some big moment like that, but I think the ideas that we're seeing in that is meant to connect to what we experience in this.
Right.
All right, Ken, what's last one?
Final one here. Let's have some fun with Star Wars marketing. Here's a question from Ace Kennedy at Ace Kennedy 23. Should the Solo movie... Solo, a Star Wars story, trailer for that. Should the trailer for Solo movie play during The Last Jedi?
Yeah, you know what's funny is normally the answer to this, every time we pose a question, if one Star Wars trailer should be in front of another Star Wars movie, it's usually no, because you don't want to lose focus on the actual movie you're about to see. I think you got to go away from that in this one, because you're looking at the Star Wars franchise itself. Han Solo is not in this movie, or if he is, it's in a flashback, but he's not in this Last Jedi film. So you want to introduce the fact that there is a new Star Wars movie with new Han Solo coming out. Why not show it to all of these people that maybe, don't be confused. There are a lot of people out there, casual movie fans, who still do not know that a Han Solo movie is coming. They have no idea. We all know because we pay attention to this stuff, but there's some people who are like, my dad has no clue that a Han Solo movie is coming out. But if he's sitting in that theater and then it pops up 6 months before it's supposed to come out, you know, it might be a good move to do it in front of the audience that's supposed to see it. Right. So I think that I think they should do it.
I don't know about this yet. I don't think I can give a really great answer until I know the quality of that trailer, because from a business perspective, yeah, it makes a ton of sense. Disney is distributing that movie. They want to promote their next movie right. using that one that is going to sell through the roof opening weekend. But, you know, I don't want to be a Debbie Downer about this, but could you imagine if the Han Solo trailer came out and it didn't meet our expectations and people saw that trailer before going into The Last Jedi? And I'm not saying The Last Jedi can't be great in a way that it shifts the tone, but if people aren't loving that trailer and it plays right before the new movie, that's a dangerous territory to play in where they are risking something. Yeah. But assuming that that trailer lives up to the standard that every other Star Wars trailer we've seen, then it should be fine, and it would just make sense from a business standpoint.
I just want a tease. Give me a tease. Give me a good one-minute teaser trailer. Maybe you don't show much. I understand not wanting to show the full trailer, because what if it isn't good? And all of a sudden, you're like still like, oh, no.
It's going to taint the beginning of the movie.
All right, let me watch
yeah.
this one.
Yeah.
If they're confident in it, maybe, but I don't think I think you get a full trailer after. You got time, a little bit of time. May's fast around this corner, but give me a tease. Put something up there. Solo yeah. a Star Wars story on the way.
All right, well, that's it. That's everything on the council today. I'd like to thank the council that joined me. Grand Moff Nemiroff, where can they find you?
I am on Twitter and Instagram, at P. Nemiroff.
Kylo Ken, where can they find your grouchy butt?
You can find me at Catnapsuck, and soon getting more popcorn in the break room.
Me, I'll be eating sushi, right, in about 10 minutes. So you can't find me there because this is pre-taped. Go ahead and check me out, Collider Jedi Council, every week here. Hashtag Collider Jedi Council. Find me at Christian Harloff. Like I said, I got the Patriots on my shirt here because they're going to go battle. They're going to do battle tomorrow on the Ultimate Schmodown. And like you saw in the beginning of this video, come to LA Comic-Con this Sunday. Make sure you check out the panel. There it is right there, the live movie trivia Schmodown panel at Comic-Con, LA Comic-Con. We hope to see you all there, and we'll check you out next time. May the Force be with you, always.
Hey, everybody, Mark Ellis here. Thanks for watching this episode. You want to watch more? Then click up here, or you can click right here for more great content from Collider. If you haven't subscribed to Collider Video, do so right now and share this vid with your friends. Thanks for watching.